So what do we do now?
We listen.
What's up, everyone? It's Mad Static, and the Saints Row series is a bit of a mess. Now, when I say a mess, though, I mean in the purest sense of the word, stripped of all negative connotations, because I really do like these games, every single one of them. But nevertheless, they're disorganized, kind of all over the place, like a party or a family or any kind of gathering, really. A mess in that sense. It's a series of crime open world games, mainly prominent throughout the 7th generation of gaming consoles, with 4 main titles released, a remaster for Saints Row 3, a spin-off following the 4th game, and a reboot set to release in August of this year. To summarize these games, in a phrase you will hear way too much in relation to the series, it's like GTA. You're a criminal in a big city, run around, steal cars, kill people, make money, yada yada. Though the series has always made strides to differentiate itself from its inspiration with cartoonishly over-the-top chaos and in-depth and varied character creation and customization options. I started the series with number 3 when it first released in 2011. OG fans of the channel may even remember some of my videos on the game from back then. Man, I'm just fucking with you. I know no one's seen that shit. And I don't blame you, cause shit it was indeed. If you can manage to decipher the prehistoric and cryptic footage you're currently seeing here, then you can somewhat make out that I am playing and recording footage of Saints Row 3. Anyways, I really love that game, and when Saints Row the 4th came out, despite being drastically different, I also really loved it and played it so much that I put myself into a state of nausea for the title that I only recovered from about 2 years ago. I then proceeded to play the Get Out of Hell spinoff and did the exact same thing to myself. It was worth it for that platinum, though. I had never really bothered with the earlier 2 titles until the start of this year, where I just happened to come across this insane deal where I got them for like $1 each. I've talked about my experiences with the first game at length already, but today, I don't want to just focus on the second game, but a revisit to Saints Row 3 as well. Despite being the 2 most similar games of the 4 main titles, the differences between Saints Row the 2nd and 3 mark a very clear divide between what these games set out to do, or at very least what they achieved in the fans' eyes. In most respects, honestly, they very much feel like proper predecessors and follow-ups to each other, respectively. But with their differences in tone, gameplay content, and emphasis, they often feel like polar opposites to each other. With those differences come a divide, and that sucks because I feel like neither of these games are getting the proper credit they deserve. I've seen too much hate for Saints Row 3 recently, too little acknowledgement of Saints Row the 2nd existing, and even at the height of these games' popularity, it feels like their biggest claim to fame was how much more crazy and exciting they were at the time than the self-serious, depressing, and much more popular GTA 4. So today I want to look at these 2 games, not just by themselves, but in relation to each other. What differences are there between the 2? What's for the better? What's for the worse? Is there even a better or worse in the difference? Essentially, what do these 2 games achieve, not just as standalone crime open world games, but as games of the Saints Row series? I'll be talking about a lot of things here, story, gameplay, world, graphics. Now, I'm sure most of you know that this isn't any kind of professional take. I'm literally just talking about my feelings as a gamer. But even with that, take extra caution when I'm talking about the graphics and performance and stuff, as I have even less of a clue what I'm talking about there. Just thought that was important to note. Let's start with Saints Row the 2nd, a game I would define primarily as ambitious. This game attempts to do a lot of things, especially coming off the baseline of what Saints Row the 1st was, double especially coming out only 2 years after that game, releasing on May 29th, 2008. Like, the leap in quality and content is pretty huge. Graphics, gameplay, the open world, the activities, the story, it's all sprawling. Saints Row the 2nd is the game in the series that, in terms of sheer scaling content, feels the closest to reaching the impossibly high standards of GTA that the series was unfairly put against at conception. In terms of matching quality though, it's definitely good, but this game constantly felt like it was too big for itself to handle, enter penis joke here. Like, its ambition outweighed what the developers could reasonably do, given their resources, time, and what this game was in general. It affects every aspect of the game in a different way, so I need to go a little bit more in depth to explain exactly what I'm talking about here, but know that it does affect every aspect of the game. I'm gonna jump right into the story as it has a handle on what many people love most about this game. I'll start with a quick rundown of the first game's plot to give context for this game, as well as the entire series. Your character is just some guy who is at the wrong place at the wrong time, but ends up being saved by a man named Julius and the gang he runs named the Third Street Saints. You're recruited in and work towards the Saints' goal of clearing the city of Stillwater from gang violence. You do this by committing gang violence. Throughout the game, you work with lieutenants of the Saints to slowly take out the other big three gangs controlling Stillwater. By the end of the game, you've managed to fight off any law enforcement that came your way and are sitting at the top of the power chain in the city. One could say you've blown up. Julius is captured by the police, and in the process of trying to get him back, you're apparently betrayed by Julius himself and lured out to a boat to be blown up, ending the first game. The second game picks up 5 years after the first game ends, where you wake up in a prison hospital, having managed to live through the explosion, but with the damage having kept you in a coma for all that time. You bust out with the help of a guy named Carlos, and he was a cool guy. He wants to help you get the gang started again, as since the time of your accident, Stillwater's changed a lot, and the Saints basically don't exist anymore. Altor is a mega corporation that holds influence on just about every industry in the city, and has drastically changed it. At that point, they're the top dogs of the city. But there are also three new gangs who have come into the city and filled the power vacuums left, and the Sons of Samdi, the Ronin, and the Brotherhood of Steel. But fuck. Once out and about, you save Johnny Gaff from a court hearing, set up a new base, recruit new lieutenants in Shondi, Pierce, and Carlos, and work to restore the Saints' power over the city as their new leader. And from there, it's the same setup as the last game. There are three linear and separate storyline paths that you can pursue and switch between at any time. They're filled with missions where you and one or more of your lieutenants find different ways to hurt the rival gang that the story path focuses on. Once all storylines are complete, you'll unlock the last story path with a few final missions to carry out. This model for the campaign offers a unique freedom in player and story progression, with the missions themselves expanding the world and never feeling dull. But the structure is also something I feel holds the story back from being truly exceptional. The structure of the game's campaign feels like a leash that holds the story back from doing anything truly special. There's a limit to how much any storytelling can do when it's constrained to a specific episode of events and isn't allowed to bleed over into anything else in the experience. A common gripe against Saints Row II is its tonal inconsistency, and I think this is one of the main reasons why. The game has some heavy-hitting moments, but they feel as if they're affecting the player more than the actual narrative, almost like they're meaningless sometimes. A great example of this is in the Brotherhood storyline. Some of you may have picked up on my subtle hint earlier that the boy Carlos doesn't make it out a-okay. He's really dragged through the mud. I'm so sorry. That death really fucked me up. The way it happens, the execution of the scene, it was all extremely effective on me and many others, and the player character, but somehow not on the rest of the story. It can be argued that the loss makes the boss much more vengeful with his actions, but honestly, they're doing similarly fucked up shit throughout the entire game. I don't think anyone else even mentions Carlos, and if they did, it wasn't for anything important. The story has these dark moments that aren't allowed to hold much effect, since the story has to account for the player's freedom and move on. The structure of the missions themselves feel restrictive in a similar way, by not allowing much creativity or variety in story events. Most missions start with a cutscene telling you what to do, followed by about 10 to 20 minutes of you doing said do, followed by a cutscene of the enemies reacting to what you do. There can be phone calls and conversations for more dialogue and in-game cutscenes that help, along with some minor twists on the starts and ends, but this is a tight restraint nevertheless. The majority of the storytelling is told in 1 to 2 minute cutscenes loosely connected by whatever crazy shit you're doing in between, leaving them to only be planning scenes, reaction scenes, or a combination of the two. It's just not an abundance for a story to work with. The last complaint I want to mention for the story is going back to the issue with tone, mainly that the game never forms a solid feeling or atmosphere. It's a bit undecided between the goofy, extraordinary action of its gameplay and premise and the more serious and gritty tone of its narrative and world. Now, it's definitely not impossible for grit and humor to mix together. I've seen a number of video game stories pull it off well, and I even just did a video about how Portal does this exact thing extremely well. But in Saints Row II, they never mix, just kind of awkwardly move out of each other's way and make space somehow. The dark elements don't leave as much impact as they should, and as a result, the comedy doesn't lighten any load. There isn't a consistently humorous tone strong enough to steal the show, so the comedy is just kind of there, like the dark elements. The game's tone feels like it's in neutral too much of the time, with both dark and light elements feeling underutilized. This problem in itself feels like the result of a mission and story structure that the ideas of the narrative can only go so far with. Though to its credit, it does go as far as it can. On the gameplay front, those 10 to 20 minutes in between cutscenes are filled with the best missions in the series, hands down. The character is taken to so many unique places, and yes, while the content is consistently driving and shooting, it remains fun throughout. Since not only is the gameplay just really solid, but it's also motivated by the events within those 2-minute cutscenes. Many people are quick to point out how dark this game's story is, and I wouldn't deny that, but I think Saints Row II is better defined by its weight. I'm calling this game fat! Just the way I like them. Nah, I'm joking. While the game isn't able to have its characters, world, or progression meaningfully impact each other, they did succeed in affecting the players, or at least me. The storytelling that is allowed to work within the game's structure is really effective and investing, to a degree that the first game only really dabbled in. Characters aren't just interesting to watch. You see the establishing and growth of trust between your character and their new allies, or the strong lasting trust between the very few old ones. The villains manage to be impressively written characters in every game in the series, and the same is true here. Even the least impressive of them are at the very least providing a suitably threatening presence, and that's what this game does strongest. I don't care whether the game is dark or gritty, I care about the palpable pressure on events and characters of the game, because the story put in the time and went through the process of fleshing it all out, and because of that, I developed real emotional stakes in the Third Street Saints and their predicament. The first game had me interested and intrigued in the game's ventures, but here, everywhere I go, everyone I meet, and everything I do feels personal, and honestly, it's all because of you. Yeah, you. Your custom character, or as they're officially known, the Playa, without an R, is the best character in this game. It's always impressed me how most of these games went the length of getting all these different voice actors to play the same character, just to give players that extra amount of choice, and still managing to get strong performances out of all of them. No matter the voice, the boss is always a fun character to play as and follow. Well, except in the first game, honestly. They were kind of annoying, they ran their mouth a little bit too much. In Saints Row II, though, there's this ruthlessness to the character that isn't showcased in any of the other games, and I really appreciated that. They still have the same personality as in the other games, but honestly, they spend most of the game understandably pissed off. It's clear that their priority right now is on establishing respect and power with a 5-year pent-up aggression let loose on those who don't fall in line. Our protagonist is a villain, no doubt to me, but it's great watching this character not shy away from being the bad guy, and that's a lot to this game's heavy moments. Now, it might sound contradictory to call the story weighty, while also saying it lacks impact. So I think my feelings of the story can best be summed up in this short segment of Raiden punching Senator Armstrong for his life. Raiden serves as the elements of the story. He's over here throwing round after round of powerful shots. Each one is visceral and fun as hell to watch. It should have as powerful of a reaction as the strikes warrant. But they don't. All this force is being put into an approach that won't have any effect. They're super fast, but they're just regular strikes. It can only help him so much. Not to mention that Raiden isn't even looking for any opening or key area to attack. It's the simplest attack strategy possible. Look at the man's chest! Why would he think attacking like that would work? Anyways, this is more or less how I feel about Saints Row II's story. It's a fun narrative to watch unfold, that's directed well, constantly engaging, and has a strongly written storyline and cast of characters that all make for an enjoyable experience. The problems lie in the conformity of the game's structure that leads to a lack of consistency in narrative beats and overall tones. With all that said, yeah, it's pretty good. Shifting focus, the city of Stillwater keeps managing to surprise me, and it's too bad that I'll probably never see it in a new game again, cause Stillwater is exceptional among the crowd of open-world sandbox gang-ridden metropolises, and that's saying something cause there's a lot of those. This is an extremely dense city, filled with a multitude of different districts and sites compacted into just 2 main islands. They cover most of the bases of urban living, high-class hotspots, working districts, and even bite-sized slices of mountain and desert areas. Each of the areas are sufficiently packed with standout sites and infrastructure, all on the same map of the first game, no less, which doesn't sound impressive until you see the comparison. There's enough differences here to make even old areas feel entirely new, without being alien. What adds to the city are the number of enterable locations, landmarks, and even secret areas lurking underground the city that makes it a lot of fun to run around and explore in. It's a standout open world, and it's really insane how much this city offers in comparison to any others I'd seen in the series to this point. Though, like the first game, it's not amazing on the visual front. Now, graphics are definitely an improvement over the first. Like, I don't know how it couldn't get better than this, but I wouldn't say it's ideal. There's a lot of different lighting and weather effects and different area aesthetics that look good in their own right, but all of this has a slightly washed out presentation to it, with a kind of fuzziness over it too. Though these are issues probably more on the fault of the technical front rather than design flaws, since technical issues are by and far this game's most damning and egregious problem. The game runs like ass. It doesn't take long or being in a specific situation to understand that Saints Row the Second isn't built quite right. From the moment I hopped on the boat with Carlos and my screen became this chopped up 144p mess, the bugginess stayed a consistent issue. In every mission, in every car ride, in every shootout, it was there. The game feels unstable, like it's constantly on the brink of a nervous breakdown. And from my understanding, the 360 version I'm playing on is one of the better optimized versions of it, so it's not an issue of platform. It is definitely worse than in the first game, since the performance there was at very least only inconsistent, whereas here, it's constantly low quality. I don't even have to be doing anything impressive, I can just be making a turn and the frames can start dropping. It's that constant. Now usually these kinds of technical issues don't hurt my experience too much, but there are too many instances where I felt its direct impact on my gameplay, often hurting when, what, and how much of something I could see. It sucks because they really went out of their way for the environments of this game, but I also feel like that might be one of the biggest influences for the abundance of technical issues. Now admittedly, the series is known to not be the most polished on the visual or gameplay side of things. The biggest problem with Saints Row the First was something I called the jank factor. Basically the amount of crazy unbalanced bullshit that happened in the chaotic situations of the game that managed to hurt the experience. Luckily, the jank factor doesn't seem to have worsened on the gameplay front. If anything, it subsided significantly. The gameplay of the second feels like a healthy improvement from the first, with both driving and shooting feeling tightened. There wasn't the most that could be improved from driving since it already worked well, but there are subtle differences in universal handling and acceleration that do make the two games' approaches feel different, with this one feeling less slippery. A change in camera perspective also helps to mix up the feeling of the game's driving, with the vehicle camera here being closer to the ground level, and actively responding to moves like drifting and large jumps. There are new and definitely welcome vehicle types in boats, motorcycles, ATVs, helicopters, and planes. It's great that they're here and all, but I swear it keeps surprising me just how much I didn't notice they weren't in the first game. Combat likewise has seen some big and small changes. Most obviously is the option to aim now, along with the camera being changed to an over-the-shoulder perspective. You can now use people as human shields and melee is much more engaging, but other than that, shooting feels relatively the same on the player's end. Now driving and combat separated were always pretty good, but last game, vehicular combat was a fucking nightmare, and here, it's still not very good, but I think what made it abhorrent in the previous title was how often you were forced to engage in it, especially in relation to being blown up by everything. So less was really more in this case, it's fine now. The AI feels a lot better and much more leveled in this game, and it's not nearly as likely to sporadically switch between this chilled out lazy mode and fucking rabbitness. Though I would still say that the difficulty balance isn't tuned quite correctly. It's not nearly as bad as in the first game, but signs of the unbalance will crop up in the late game. Note that this is exclusively talking about enemy AI. You can still recruit your own gang members to help you and they still manage to actually do that. Enemies are mostly engaging throughout the game, but there will come a certain point where you are just mowing through bodies with what feels like no push or resistance. When things do get difficult, it's due to an almost instantaneous death caused from sources of damage like explosions and fire that, first off, come out of dipshit nowhere, and second, do way too much damage, for damage that comes out of nowhere. It really hurts the mindless chaos of the game, one of its defining features. Through notorieties 1 through 4, it's a zero effort killing. Enemies die too fast and don't swarm quickly enough. At notoriety 5, I get blown up or burned to death from getting blown up or just get hit by a car. No part of the entire rampage process was really fun. Overall though, gameplay's fine. While they weren't able to stomp out some of the series' lingering issues to that point, they made small but effective changes and improvements. Before I can wrap up talking about the second of the Saints Rows, I gotta talk about what's out there in that big open world I'm so fond of. As an open world experience, I feel like Saints Row the Second pays off an investment. The more you care about this world and its happenings, the more you'll get out of seeing what it has to offer. One of the ways the first two games built that investment is through something I call the hustle. Progress through the main story is halted by respect points. Think of them as like tokens you need to play the main story. If you run out of respect tokens, you'll need to get more by earning respect, and you gain respect by doing basically anything else around the open world. On top of that, you'll find yourself needing to earn extra money for health items, customization options, and especially ammo. All of this incentivizes the player to actually engage with the extra content in the open world, instead of just flying through the main game. It's really important that this process feels natural and the content stays interesting, or it could really hurt the entire experience, having the majority of the time feeling like it's spent on boring chores or a tedious grind. I feel that this game does this process well, while admittedly not as well as the first. Now that's because the first game's situation was fucking dire, as I constantly felt broke or useless in the beginning, which pushed me to grow my character, as the content always felt fun. The same sentiment is true here, though the investment in the side content mainly came from my own sense of wanderlust, as I didn't feel nearly as helpless. Customization also influenced my engagement, but I'd be lying if I said it was as strong as in the last title. I think with how expansive this game felt in most areas, the customization options in this game felt limited, or at least not pushed enough. The character creator is an exception, that's always strong, but clothing had me feeling a little bit underwhelmed. The insane amount of detail from the first game is still here, but it felt lacking in variety. The first game didn't have a lot either, but it felt like it gave a good, plentiful amount for the simplest clothing options. They were basic, but it felt like all bases were covered. Here, it feels like some of those choices were thrown out, and focus was instead put on the variety of arrangements for the broadest types of wear. It could just be a personal thing, but I felt like my clothing choices weren't as expansive. Car customization is more or less the same, which is disappointing since there was clearly a lot of places they could have gone from the very basic setup they established. And while the options to change your safe house and gang members are nice additions, they also felt somewhat superfluous to my experience. The customization front is still at large here, but it wasn't really pushing me to do too much. The side missions you'll be doing in between the main story do a really solid job of expanding on the gameplay. Of course, there are the minor activities and mini-games you can choose to participate in, and while they don't offer too much in terms of content or reward, they're definitely welcome. But I'm talking mainly about the strongholds, the territory system in general, and the activities. Each gang holds specific pieces of the map as territory that the Saints can gain with every main story mission or stronghold mission finished, with the stronghold missions usually having you run up in a building or landmark and airing it out appropriately. But even after a territory is taken, you might experience something called a pushback, where the rival gang attempts to take back the territory, which has the entire area become a fighting ground until you kill the leaders of the attack. Strongholds and pushbacks were my favorite parts of the last game, but the main missions here are so standout that they end up outshining the other two. They're both still a lot of fun though. Now when it comes to the activities, I once again find myself finding them as fine. They're okay. It's a mixed bag of different levels of enjoyment. Though to their credit, I can't say there's more than one I actively dislike. Again though, I'm not going to mention all of them because I barely have anything to say about the ones I want to. Escort is still a personal pet peeve of mine, not due to anything other than me being annoyed at the concept of ducking these aggressive ass vans and doing a bunch of stupid shit while two people fuck in the back of my car. Other than that, the lows really aren't that bad for me. Septic Avenger is probably the most boring once you get over the poop is funny aspect of it. The combo meter in Mayhem turns a simple and clean concept into a boring slog where the optimum strategy is to run over and blow up a bunch of fences. It's just public property, I don't understand it. Okie doke. Crowd control can become somewhat irritating when like 10 people are swarming your target and a random number of them start pulling out fucking guns and make it impossible. Heli Assault also has a difficulty problem because again, explosions and enemy AI have no filter here. But other than that, this one is actually a lot of fun. So are the regulars like insurance fraud, drug trafficking, and snatch. Same concepts and they still work really well, though the approach for insurance fraud has changed slightly. I also found Fuzz to be a welcome new addition. I thought that this one played out really well. Lastly, I gotta mention the extents that Demolition Derby, Hitman, and Chop Chop were improved. These used to be at best ass and at worst non-functional, but here, not only do they work most of the time, but they're also pretty fun in their own right. And that's about it. With all that said, Saints Row II is a game that has a lot of noticeable flaws, but still manages to stand out and warrant respect for how committed it is to making the most of what it is. The narrative stumbles in its disorganized story structure and tones, but I think the fact that they even got me to care about elements like that in this game helps to show what it was able to accomplish in the first place. Actual care. Beyond that, the campaign is constantly fun, in big part due to the city of Stillwater, and how enjoyable it is to explore and play around in the layered and bustling city. It's the best part of Saints Row II, but may also contribute to its worst attribute, being the fragile feeling state of the game's optimization, which affects the quality of everything in the game. Most of all graphically, but least of all gameplay-wise, as the driving, combat, and AI are significantly improved from the previous work, even though problems from there don't feel fully resolved. It all adds up to an open-world game that isn't perfect or pristine by any means, but becomes a personally passionate and powerful experience. That's Saints Row II. Released 3 years later on November 15th, 2011, with Saints Row 3. This game slaps! Saints Row 3 is a game I primarily define as absurd, for a lot of reasons that honestly contradict themselves. It's an absurdly smart game while also being absurdly stupid, and not always on purpose like it means to be. It's an absurdly fun game while at times being absurdly dull. And it's an absurdly impressive game while also being absurdly underwhelming. It's absurd! But again, I got this game at release. It's the Saints Row that I've spent the most time with, by a large margin. This was my childhood. Yes, sir. But coming back to the game after all these years, I found once adorable aspects haven't aged the best over time, while also finding new and really fun stuff that I used to overlook. But most importantly, I now have two things that I didn't when first playing Saints Row 3. I mean, for one, adulthood, but secondly, the experiences of the first and second game. This might be a point of contention for some, as a lot of people say that an entertainment product should be judged as its own thing, and separated from the bias of previous experiences. And I mostly agree with that. Like, I'm probably never gonna hate a good game because it didn't do what I wanted it to do as a sequel, or because I don't consider it a good follow-up, but I also don't think bias from the previous experiences are worthless when it comes to criticism or praise. If you have a game, or a movie, or a show that's serving as a continuation of another, then I believe there's a place for judgment on how it treats or relates to that prior investment. Does it reward the prior investment? Does it expand on it meaningfully? Does it differentiate at all? If there are differences, then how do they affect the experience and the investment? There are a lot of different directions the discussion can go in, and it's all rarely objective, but I still think it's important to look at. It was easy with Saints Row the first to second, because there, it was mostly cut and dry upgrades, with like one or two downgrades. They were very easy to classify as objective improvements or diminishments. Well, as objective as possible. But with the second to three, many of the changes aren't strictly for better or worse, just differences in approach that make the issue complicated. The objective quality comes first and foremost, but the sequel bias is still relevant to a degree. To be honest, this whole last paragraph is mainly relevant when leading into the story because jeez! Jesus Christ. By the time Saints Row 3 takes place, the Saints have faded away from the identity of dangerous gangbangers and embraced the fame as corporate celebrities after taking over Altor. Now they deal in movies and advertising their brand more than murder and ascending the criminal underworld. Though they still do that from time to time, what the fuck is going on with my script? And through a botched bank robbery, they managed to piss off an Organization 13. I don't know why I called it that. An organization called the Syndicate, a collective of three gangs in the Deckers, the Morningstar, and the Luchadors. You manage to escape their capture, but in the process lose Johnny Gat and are thrown into the unfamiliar city of Steelport. On top of that, the city eventually calls in the anti-gang militia named Stag to help take out the Syndicate, the Saints, and their warfare. From there, it's a pretty familiar setup. Take out the big three competitors with the help of your allies, overcome law enforcement, and take over the city. Looking at the story as its own narrative and what it accomplishes by and for itself, it is perfectly okay. It's not standout or truly great storytelling or anything special, and that's fine because it's not trying to be. That's not what it's here for, or at least not what you're getting out of it. The campaign here serves as a great companion piece to the gameplay, as a means to do crazy things in this crazy world of this crazy game. Its tone is constantly comical and crass and silly and stupid, and it's great. Now, since the game is constantly joking, not all the humor is always landing, but the sense of humor does keep the world constantly energetic. Like, come on, this is funny. The characters are also charismatic, not specifically deep personalities or anything, but for the most part, they're likable enough. The entire game's atmosphere is charming and playful and helps to encourage the gameplay, make everything feel cohesively wacky. It all makes for a decently engaging world to mess around in, and while I wouldn't say it was ever enough to attach me to the world, it never felt like it had to. They fly off the rails sometimes, like how Stag and the brute cloning thing is a little bit too sci-fi even for this game, and I don't even know what the hell was going on with the Burt Reynolds zombie mission thing, but the campaign never bored or annoyed me, and I never felt like it was lacking because it never felt like the main focus of the game. More so an avenue for the real main focus of the game, in the chaotic goofiness, to be expressed, which it did really well. But this game isn't just its own story, it's a sequel. A sequel in a series that, at this point, was known for its stories taking themselves somewhat seriously and being fairly important to the game's overall experience. In its regards as a follow-up, Saints Row 3 is one of the most whiplash-inducing changes in story focus I have ever seen, and sadly, also one of the most disappointing. It's telling that I never thought much of the stories of Saints Row until playing the first two games, and just how absolutely befuddled I was at them being, well, actually competent. Now, I still don't think the story is that bad. At least not as bad as some of you guys think, like some of these niggas hate this game. Like, it's obviously a dramatic tone shift from the first and second game, but the series has always been kinda goofy, and if the creators wanted to shift more focus onto that goofy side, it was definitely possible. I like the dark elements of the second, but I really don't think the story had to be dark to work out, and the tone of this game is okay, even for Saints Row, it still feels faithful, as long as the story of this game created a smooth and natural transition that fit within the context of what the narrative and storyline had set up so far. But did it do that? Well, actually almost. Let's go back to the very end of the second, the secret mission where you confront the old Saints leader, Julius, for trying to kill you. He says that he set you up because you were too ruthless, too power hungry. Which is kinda hard to believe considering your character in the first, but anyways, it was in order to stop the Saints from becoming the very thing they had always fought against. These giant groups like the Vice Kings or Altor, who so effortlessly walked over the less fortunate, or smaller lives they considered not important in pursuit of their never-ending goals. Anyways, Saints Row 3 sees you becoming just that thing Julius was fearing, completely motivated by money and nothing else, but through the loss of one of your closest allies. Someone who was there from the beginning, the first person you think of when thinking about the Saints. It pushes you out of the complacent mindset of making more money, and starts a new stride towards power, doing what got you there in the first place. But as you're going through, there's a sense of self-aware deja vu, as at the end of it all, you gotta decide whether you're gonna repeat the process of the never-ending power struggle, or actually do something with the power you gain, to change things for the better. It's the perfect baseline for a sequel to the prior two games, and it's exactly the one Saints Row 3 uses. So how did it not work? Like, at all? I said earlier the biggest strength within the second game's story was the emotional weight it was able to create and carry, and I feel like that same weight is the biggest thing missing from 3's. Jokes and levity are great and all, but the story can't just be punchlines. There's gotta be building blocks. Moments of establishment and development and conclusiveness, you know, the things that make a story. But it feels like 3 only just recognizes these essential pieces, without putting a lot of time into them. Great example. Johnny? What the fuck was that? People want to talk about Joel being done dirty. Imagine they did that shit over a walkie-talkie. Again, killing Gat isn't a bad idea. It even has potential to be a very powerful moment. But it's like the problems I had with the death of Carlos and the second's dark moments in general, except exacerbated. At least those dark moments had appropriate build-up before it and within the moment, but I can't even say it's present here. It just rings hollow when looking at the death objectively. Now, if you want to add sequel bias into the equation and recognize that this guy was the longest-standing friend you had and was integral to the story to this point, then it almost rings disrespectfully. I'm sorry, I'm trying not to sound like so offended by a video game story, but I do want to communicate how unfulfilling the death was for those who had already known the character. The scenario was executed so badly that the fake out aliens kidnapped him thing they put in the fourth was honestly the best decision they could have made from a narrative point. The rest of the story setup has similar pitfalls, good ideas that lack any sense of weight to them. Characters and plot points with already engaging stories just sitting there, undelivered. And it's weird because you'd probably assume these problems to arise from the game's overcomedic tone, but I really don't think that's the issue. I still believe seriousness and goofiness can make a great combination, and the game, at almost every turn, has the chance to make the mixture. There's obviously some situations that can only benefit from being dumb, but most of the time the game provides itself with great opportunities to be both funny and developmental, and then decides to only be funny. In most cutscenes or dialogue, characters can easily crack their jokes and then add layers to their character or situation all in the same scene or conversation. They just don't do it! I was sitting there so many times thinking about how well the current gags could lead into something actually important, and then they just stop. Now, some points are well delivered, I won't say it's all misses. Killbane and Cyrus make a great pair of main enemies, as Killbane is fun to watch but not really threatening, and Cyrus is threatening while not being very interesting. But both of them are outshone by the best character in the game, Pierce, and I'm not joking. Pierce was kind of the awkward comic relief character in Saints Row II, and he's the exact same here. But now, Pierce gets to be a completely goofy ass dude in a completely goofy ass game. He revels in it, and was a lot of fun to be around. Because again, if there's one thing the game gets absolutely right in regards to the story, it's that completely goofy ass theming. There's a few other things I want to try and quickly go through before I move on. When it comes to actually playing through the campaign and its missions, it's a bit of a downgrade from what came before. There aren't as many unique locales or locations, but it still stays entertaining because the gameplay is entertaining. Mission structure has changed a bit. It's now a lot more linear with only a few times where you can decide which missions you want to do first. It doesn't have too much effect though, since it's still the same mission formula of getting directions, doing objectives, and the enemy saying dang it or dying or something. Last thing, or technically things, are the two endings of the game. Going back through them, it's a really weird situation. During the second to last mission of the game, you run around the city and stop by areas where Stag and the Luchadors are waging war, and put an end to it. It's a very fun mission actually, but at the end of it, you run into a problem. The IKEA lady from Stag plans to blow up the fake Statue of Liberty and blame the Saints for it by leaving a kidnapped Shandi and Viola to be blown up and found in the wreck. So that's not good. But at the same time, Killbane is getting away. And he's an asshole. So that's not good. You're left with the choice of saving your pals or getting Killbane. So there's obviously a canon ending, considering the fourth game and an extra what-if scenario, but the way they both play out makes it feel like the roles are reversed. If you save your friends, then the Saints are praised as heroes, Stag is kicked out of the city, and the final mission sees you starring in a sci-fi movie called Gangsters in Space. I think you make up with Killbane, I'm not sure if that's actually him or just an actor, and then the game just kinda ends. It's definitely the canon ending, since Shandi, Viola, and Cyrus are alive in the next game, but there's like zero closure to anything. The space mission was fun though. The second option sees you stopping Killbane's plane in a sequence that feels like an homage to a mission that still fuels my nightmares. Once stopped, he gives a final monologue before you beat the absolute shit out of him and snap his neck. The guy of Liberty blows up, Shandi and what's-her-name die, and the city allows Stag to bring in a fucking helicarrier. All of this to kill a man who honestly never did anything that bad to you. Anyways, the last mission sees us flying up to the giant fortress, planting a bomb at key locations, and fighting off Cyrus and a VTOL. Once Stag has been destroyed, you and the gang break into a new station to remind everyone watching that the Saints rule Steelport, kind of making an independent city-state thing. Now this ending isn't canon, but it's also an actual ending. There's actual finality to the events of the game, there's a big bombastic final mission that incorporates everything the game's made you do so far, we see where the group is left standing, and everything's finished. That's how you conclude a story. Just not this one. Nothing about the way the game has been operating up to this point in tone, plot, or characters fit appropriately with the themes of this ending, making it feel unearned. So the sensical ending doesn't even feel like a real ending, and the ending that feels like an ending doesn't feel warranted. They really should have just combined these endings into like one, with the Gangsters in Space portion being like a secret ending mission like they had in the last game. Other than that though, I covered everything I want to say about the story of this game. While it accomplishes what it set out to do in putting together a fun world, campaign, and feeling overall, I find it largely defined by what it could have done, but ultimately didn't. A story that's altogether okay, but can feel lacking in an overflowing amount of missed potential, given what it's provided. It all rounds out to a story that feels alright if inconsequential to most players, but also a story that feels like a slap in the face, or at least inconsiderate, to those who were previously invested in the series' storyline. You know, looking at this script, most of the video is spent talking about the two game stories, which surprises me since I don't feel like the stories are the most important parts of the games in either cases. I mean, they're definitely worth talking about, and it makes sense considering the strengths and weaknesses of the stories need a little more context to explain, but it does feel somewhat strange since I don't consider the stories to be the best or worst things about either game. I'd say their most defining features in both cases are the open worlds these games provide, with Stillwater being the best thing about Saints Row II, and Steelport being the most absolutely disappointing thing from Saints Row 3. Flat out the worst thing. Steelport is unbearably boring. Like, what happened here? I mean, actually, it's kind of clear what happened. The team reasonably didn't want to give players Stillwater for the third time in a row. A Saints Row! But with a whole half year of development thrown out the window and the publisher THQ being on death's door, they really had to rush to put something together. I understand what they came up with was never gonna be as impressive as the city that had two games worth of development, But I'd say from an objective and biased point of view alike that Steelport is one of the most boring open world cities I've ever been in. The entire city, along with the very few interiors present, all encompass the same style of this bland mixture between suburban and big city. Every inch of the city looks the same. It's a shame too, because I think the game's visual aesthetic actually holds up really well, but the game rarely uses it in any kind of creative environment. It's always the same lifeless default style. They try to stick some ginormous landmarks and eye catchers around the map to bring some life to it, but even as a child playing this, I always noticed just how often I was seeing different buildings and streets and blocks and entire sections of the map that looked almost identical to each other. I'd be on one island in Steelport and mistake it for one on the entire other side of the game world. It's spacious and provides plenty of room to go crazy, but is a massive downgrade from what came before, and doesn't stand out at all from the most generic crime overworld cities. Back to the visuals though, yeah, I think they're pretty good overall. The models in the world have a cartoonish style that suits the chaos and mood really well. Explosions and crashes and killings look lush and impactful, and during night sometimes, or even the rare cases that the game's lighting is allowed to do something different, the game becomes so vibrant that even the bland and tasteless Steelport becomes beautiful. Again, I don't think the game does enough with this look, but it's pleasant to look at, and really helps in giving the game and series its own personality. Which is why I'm not in a rush to play that remaster, honestly. While the environments definitely look improved, the cartoon aesthetic doesn't look as prevalent, and that's what I really liked about it, so, and I can wait a bit. Now, there are gonna be moments where even the simplistic graphics of this game start bugging out and not working correctly, but they aren't really intrusive, which is where I should probably mention what I'm playing this on. While I haven't touched the remaster yet, I played the original version of 3 on every platform except PC. Right now though, I'm playing the worst running version of the game in the 2019 Switch port. Why? Don't worry about it. What's important is that while it mostly works, optimization was pretty lackluster for docked mode. It still runs better than the best version of Saints Row II, but it's got an 11-year advantage, so we're fucking better. 3 still keeps the series tradition of not being very polished at all, but they're back to being more funny hiccups than actually immersion breaking. I'm saying that the game works, basically. It looks relatively the same on other platforms, but it's like going from a 480p resolution to 1080p. It's that kind of difference from Switch to anything else. So, funny editing note, it was at this point in the script where I was reading over it all and decided, I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about here. I should probably add a heads up on the start of this video about that. It's like, I still want to get my thoughts out about it, because, you know, that's what this video is about, it's about my feelings. But whereas most of the time I think I can point out what and where my feelings are coming from, you know, things like that, I don't feel as confident doing it with these type of issues. For the first, and honestly only time in the entire series so far, I can say that bugs and technical difficulties aren't a big issue. They're still common, but they don't significantly affect the experience in any way. And most importantly, and leading into the next section, they don't affect the gameplay in any way. The gameplay of Saints Row 3 isn't just the best thing in this game, it's the best thing in the entire series, in my opinion. Man, I love opting out of bold statements. It's the first time that the series is able to consistently achieve and maintain the hectic anarchist chaos that it's known for, and the only game in the series that feels like it's able to properly balance the strength of both sides. I've talked about the jank factor multiple times when going over the first and second, but with Saints Row 3, I'm glad to say it's gone. It's just not here. No situation feels like it's without a semblance of danger, or as if it's abruptly ended by one mega threat. A few changes contribute to the overall improvement, but I think the biggest one is the inclusion of character upgrades that allow you to increase your character's health, resistance, damage, etc., stuff like that. You don't just feel like you're in the midst of a rampage, sometimes even ending up as a casualty of randomness. You become the Eye of the Storm, able to take and give obscene amounts of damage, even the dreaded explosions. The only things able to decimate your health bars are things like lasers and miniguns that are saved for the highest notorieties and are overstated enough appearances that you actually have a chance to deal with them before they kill you. Enemies overall also feel appropriately balanced for your newfound power, as they actually show up in challenging numbers and frequency, can take a greater amount of damage, and have much more utility than in previous titles, where they either shot you, ran over you, or got a helicopter and then went pow. While gameplay is fundamentally the same as in the second game, the new means that have been added to the system have drastically improved the feeling of gameplay, making for the optimal versions of crime shooting and driving gameplay the series set out to make. The crime shooting and driving. The addition of quick melee adds a subtle but effective kinetic flow to shootouts, while also being fun to watch. There are now 4 separate types of throwables, including grenades, tear gas, molotovs, and that one electric one that occupy their own space on the weapon wheel. The place grenades previously held is now for special weapon types, which is exactly what it sounds like. While I can't say driving or drive-by shooting feels very changed at all, besides cannonball jacking, by the way, best addition, I can say that aerial vehicles, tanks, and whatever fits in between those two have become heavily implemented and engaging to use in the game. I don't care how stupid some of this stuff is, and to be honest, you don't either. Come on, this is fun. Now, there is a fair argument to be made that some of these upgrades go a bit too far. Like, literally make you invincible too far. But to even be able to get those upgrades, you need to be damn well close to 100% completion with the game. Either that, or you've just rampaged a lot. I'd say that for the work that needs to be put in, they can be warranted. Plus, I don't think it hurts the fun of the game too bad. I mean that, even though any and all threat disappears and the imbalance of threat was a big problem I had with the series until this point, I don't know. As someone who's 100% in this game before, along with the 4th and Gat Out of Hell, which requires mindlessly rampaging for a sickening amount of time, I never grew weary of the gameplay specifically. Like, don't get me wrong, I got dead fucking tired of these games for a while, but the simplistic gameplay was never the issue. It was actually therapeutic in a sense, and still is a little bit. You can just sit there, thinking about your life. If I did have one gripe with the gameplay, it would be that while your character adapts to the upped chaos, and your enemies adapt to the upped chaos, your allies don't. The AI, specifically for your gang, struggles to keep pace in the madness, often finding themselves stuck in a barrage of fire, or cars, or explosions. They're basically you from the last two games. It makes hanging out with them and including them in your quality time killing sprees much less encouraged, and honestly, more of a hassle than anything. But you know what, fuck friends, you got a tank. In conclusion, the gameplay really slaps. While Saints Row 3 functions great as an action experience, I'm a bit less enthusiastic about it as an open world game. And that's not just because Steelport sucks, though it does contribute a lot to the feeling. The yearn to explore, personally progress, and engage with everything on offer are things I draw most from these type of games, but also things I don't feel satiated in Saints Row 3. A big part of the first two games' ability to do this was the self-coined hustle mechanic I talked about, that made you go into Stillwater and engage with his activities to be able to progress the main story. That's not here in 3, it's gone, with Respect now serving as basically your character level instead of what it previously was. While I didn't think the hustle was essential or irreplaceable, there isn't really anything pushing players to engage with the game's open world format anymore. I mean, exploration ain't gonna do, that's for damn sure. And while I think the need to level up was supposed to substitute for the hustle, I never really reached a point in the game where I felt pressured to do anything but fly through the main story. It kept the flow of upgrades and difficulty balance, which is good, but made everything else in the game seem like just regular open world content, whereas it felt like a little bit more than that before. Switching topics for a second, in-game incentives, primarily customization, feels pretty good. Some much added options were added to what you can do with cars, there are upgrades to your guns and gang and other stats of that effective nature, but player customization, it could be better. It's crazy saying that since I'm pretty sure seeing people make Hulk and Homer Simpson with the Apocalypse is what made me get this game in the first place. And yeah, for goofy shit like that, the customization definitely still delivers. But 11 years later, my tastes have evolved a little bit. I require something a little more sophisticated. And in that regard, I feel like Saints Row 3 has done the opposite of the second. It's traded out detail for sheer variety. You don't have the in-depth options of sagging your pants or buttoning your shirt or putting your hoodie up. Your only choice is the piece of clothing and its color. Given the development circumstances, it's understandable. But another problem is that the game focuses so much on generally covering almost every base look possible that there are barely any other options for a specific base, even the really simple and broad appealing ones. There is only one shop for actual clothes people would wear, with the three others being a sex shop, a Halloween store, and a weird mix of all three. Do you know how hard it is to find normal clothing in this game? There's like one option in each category for business clothes, or homeware, or hot weather, or cold, with the other options being as far-reaching as a 70s hippie to whatever the fuck this is. And if you don't like the one option that they have for the look you're looking for, that's too bad. Would you like to be a furry? In the end, I gave up trying to look any sort of respectable and gave into stupidity. My best outfits are the Hood Eskimo and the Walter White. Again, good on the crazy friend, like, come on. Come on. But I was unreasonably upset that I couldn't put socks on my dress shoes. Focusing back on the open world stuff, there are a number of things cut from previous titles that, while necessary being left behind and unnecessary having been included, I can't help but be kinda sore about. The territory system inspired from San Andreas isn't a part of the game anymore, and with that, neither are territory pushbacks or strongholds. The one positive of this removal is how the gangs stay around even after being defeated, but since the story missions here don't deliver as much as the seconds did, there's now a pretty big hole that hurts visual appeal, explorative motives, the feeling of player progression throughout the world, and the already lacking appeal of Steelport. Gang operations don't even come close to covering it. Those are over in like 3 to 10 seconds. Now the survival mode and the similar horde mode, Look what they see, what they did with the W. Anyways, they're pretty fun, but honestly, not fun enough to mention beyond this. They're just kind of there. And finally, I said it once, I said it twice, and one more time we'll make it thrice. The activities are fine. Still not anything I'd say is bad, but also a bit less to actually say is good. I still hate Escort, but they did manage to significantly improve it with Tiger Escort. You drive around a tiger. It's kind of funny, I guess. A lot of people don't know, but Hitman and Chop Shop are still here, except disguised as assassinations and vehicle theft in the Saints Book option. They are also fine. Challenges are whatever, and Cyber Trailblazing is actually pretty cool, but some of my favorites from previous games, like Trafficking and Snatch, are now a lot less fun because of the decrease in AI not being stupid I was talking about earlier. The only ones I'd say I'm specifically fond of are Heli Assault, which remains pretty fun, and Professor Genki's Game Show, which actually surprised me with how much enjoyment I got from it. The combo gauge had me rushing to get kills, the brutes and non-refilling health bar actually added tension, and we actually got some visual variety in the place. It was pretty great. And that's everything I have to talk about in regards to Saints Row 3 exclusively. Looking back on it, it makes a lot of sense that this is the most popular Saints Row game, and the one that really made everyone notice the series. For one, the game actually used purple to represent itself. Seriously, why was this the first one to do that? As someone who knows jack shit about advertising, I can say that this was a pretty massive oversight on the marketing division's part. Secondly, the game chose to buckle down and key in on the aspects that really made the series stand out. Those being the chaotic gameplay, customization, and being a little bit more crazy than other games. And doing that created the best functioning, best feeling, and most fun Saints Row game to date, gameplay-wise. Also probably for about 2 more months, unless the reboot really fumbles the bag somehow. But in terms of the other aspects that can be drawn from games, the other aspects that the previous Saints Row games weren't able to achieve, 3 doesn't feel like it offers that much. It's definitely fun, at its purest, but genuine care is hard to gain from what the story provides, with a lack of eventfulness or awe coming from its narrative, campaign, and missions. Steelport still sucks ass, and there just isn't a lot to gain from this game as an open world experience. In that regard, it's really bland. A game that underbakes many of the appealing aspects that come from video games, but in order to focus all in on the absurdly fun gameplay it's able to present. That's Saints Row 3. So yeah, I think after going through both of them, it's pretty clear how these two games specifically divide most fans of the franchise. They're all around the same general idea, but with drastically different approaches that appeal to different people. I imagine most fans have a pretty clear-cut opinion on the better entry, but as someone who really likes both of them, the answers are anything but clear-cut. Again, they feel so similar, but end up striving for and achieving different things. Saints Row II has got the better story and city, no way around that. I had complaints about it, I thought it could be better, but I genuinely cared about the missed potential because it already got me invested in craving to see more. I also complained at length about 3's story, but that's only because of how much potential was thrown away from the seconds. The same thing can be said to an extent about Stillwater in comparison to Steelport. I had noticed the place was repetitive before, but the true weight of Steelport's disappointment didn't really hit me until I discovered Stillwater, and just how much more was put in there. While Saints Row II has many more things it does better than 3, its sequel does have this one small little bitty detail that it does kind of prosper in, that being that it's a better functioning game. On the visual, performance, and overall gameplay front, Saints Row 3 does everything a good sequel should do, universally improving and evolving what came before while still feeling like it new. There's no way to beat around the bush here. Saints Row 3 is just more fun. Funny thing is though, it was after I finished up analyzing all this stuff and started looking through the extra content that I realized what it was I appreciated most from these two titles. I'm not gonna talk about the DLC because I don't wanna, but I found myself craving to go through the extra missions of the second and see what would happen. Once everything was over and done with in that game, I found the temptation to do it all over again. It wasn't really fun going around and mindlessly killing, I just wanted to start a new save and re-experience everything. Exploring the city, going through the story, taking over territory, building up my character, and rising to the top. Basically, the temptation you get after finishing a complete package, where there's nothing much better to do than doing it again. But in Saints Row 3, I got the exact opposite feeling. I have no want to restart the game, and I was kind of blank-headedly going through the DLC's missions so I could get the new stuff to fuck around with. Because running through the streets of Steelport and blowing things up for hours on end is endlessly entertaining, and I refuse to pretend like it's not. In the end, both of these are still decently typical crime open world games, but with one being a more remarkable experience, and the other being a more replayable one. Saints Row 2 applies amazing amounts of ambition that, while flawed, hope to create a very personal, investing, and impressive crime game that's especially strong in its open world and campaign experience. Saints Row the Third decides to go all in and focus on its absurd nature to create an endlessly addictive action game, whose mechanics stand the test of time 11 years later. Of course, all of this is subjective and my own opinion, but if you take anything seriously or definitive from this video, let it be that neither of these games are better than GTA 4. I don't know what some of you people were on, but I'd like to try it, please. It's not up for discussion, hands down. And stop all this GTA 4 slander before I do something crazy. Like make an hour-long video defending it crazy.